deal with situation. The same things with the Sahaba. This is how we should follow our deen. Sometimes, yes, we will see things. Sometimes we will see things that we may disagree with. But we have to also understand that the knowledge out there, it is so humongous and it's so big, and we only know so little of it. So if we see something that is strange, but we know it's not haram, but we do not know about it, then we should seek to know about it. Yes, we should learn one school of thought, but we should know about the other. So when we see it, and we see somebody else do it, we understand this is a different way to do it. For example, praying witr. Praying witr. Where I come from, they pray witr two on one. They pray two rak'ah, they make salam, they pray one by itself, and they make the dua out loud after the rukut. This is a one-way school of thought. Some people do, they pray it in three rak'ah together, and they make the dua silent. Now, just because these people pray it that way, that doesn't mean that you shouldn't pray with them because they pray different. No, you should pray with them. But at the same time, you could also pray witr at home, because some people will want to pray witr after they pray a couple of tahiyyat al-masjid. So do not come to conclusion, oh, this person didn't want to pray with me because I'm praying different. You have to, this is very important, because that's where the shaitan comes. Because the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam in his last sermon says, the shaitan knows he's not going to get you now in the big things, but he will get between you in the little things. Just how we are divided by race and culture, also we are divided in our own deen. He will use the different ways that we practice our religion to divide us. And this is very important. We have to have the wisdom of the companions and the wisdom of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It is extremely important. So the first important tool is to learn. To learn what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is trying to teach us. Is extremely important, because Islam, it is not something that is comprehended by your brain only. It is comprehension by brain, but understanding with heart. You need your brain to comprehend, yes, but you also need your heart to understand. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as I said before, that He says the people of the fire, they have heart, they cannot comprehend with. So we must open our heart to try to comprehend. We must be true to ourselves. To truly, we want to acknowledge the knowledge. We want to know the knowledge solely so we will be saved. Solely that we understand. Because most of the people, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, طه ما أنزلنا عليك القرآن لتشقى إلا تذكرة لمن يخشى. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, O Muhammad, we have not revealed the Quran to you, so we will cause hardship for you. We will cause hardship for you. It is only a reminder for those people that are God-fearing, that want to know what is their destination. And this is very important to understand, because majority of us, we look at the Quran, we really look at the Quran as a book of religion only. Only beneficial is religion. But we have confusion. What is really religion? Religion is your source of happiness, your source of how to live your life. The wisdom that you will gain from the Quran and understanding what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the creator of you and everybody else, is trying to tell you is a beneficial in your materialistic life and your spiritual life. It is beneficial, will be acknowledged by those who do not believe, by those who are Muslims, by those who are non-Muslim, will be acknowledged by everyone. So it is a beneficial tool to progress ahead. Do not be confused. It is just a tool that teaches me how to pray or how to be a better Muslim. Because the best of Muslims, it is the best of human beings. Regardless whoever disagree with that. So as long as we understand that, then we should at least take the book, read it, to become the best of human beings. To be respected by others. To be respected by your enemies. Salahuddin Ayyubi, even his enemy, the enemy, Salahuddin Ayyubi, who opened Al-Quds, his enemies even said, even till today, even though they hated him, but they respected the way he was. They respected his character. They respected his strength. They respected his tragedies. They respected his deen. They respected the way he lived his life. Because they had saw a value in it. They saw a value in it. And this is why we should read the Quran. This is why we want to attain wisdom. Because if we only read in Islam and understand in Islam to understand how we do the rituals and how we do their things, But our rituals and the things and the Islam and the name that we are under is not reflecting our character, then brothers and sisters, we are doing something wrong. We need to go back. We really need to go back and understand, how can I revise my character? How can I better my character? Was this the character of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Was this the character of all the companions and the prophets? Yes, we all gonna have differences. We all gonna have differences, no matter what. Like Umar ibn Khattab was different than Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. They were different people. They had different character. But they all had beautiful character. They all had beautiful character. For example, Umar ibn Khattab was more aggressive. He was more aggressive. He was so aggressive that when he heard about the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he went to kill him. That was his intention. But he accepted Islam. When he heard the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam had died, he took out his sword. And he said, "Who has said that? I will kill him. We have among us hypocrites and liars." Because he did not want to believe that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam died. Because he had so much love for the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Yes, he was a different character. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu had a different character. He says, "Whoever worshipped the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he is dead. And whoever worshipped Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he is over everlasting. He does not die." But at the same time, they were the same believers. They had different characters. So we have to understand that. Brothers and sisters, trust me. That saying that says when one finger that you point at somebody, there is 10 pointing at you, it is a true saying. We can see the mistake of other people, but we can't see our own mistakes. If you're in the corner talking about somebody in the masjid, or talking about a Muslim brother or a non-Muslim, anybody, there is somebody else talking about your flaws. This is a literally true statement. If you understand that, then you understand, yes, the people have flaws, but their flaws does not make them rejectable, does not make them that you should not be associating yourself with them, does not make them evil people, does not people that are doomed to go to hell. This is not what it is, because just like how they have flaws, you have flaws. We have to be accepting of these things. We have to be able to be there to help these people how they help us. We have to train ourselves to be like that. Because it takes time to realize that. And as Muslims, that's what makes us brothers and sisters. We see each other's flaws, yes. But we still pray for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to have mercy on us and those other people. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, if mankind did not have flaws and did not make mistakes, he will demolish them, destroy them, and bring others that would commit mistakes so they could repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So none of us are perfect. None of us are perfect. So do not get angry at a mistake that you see from your Muslim brother and sister. Correct it with the way of wisdom. Correct it without insulting. Correct it in the right way, because in the wrong way, you cannot correct something in the wrong way. As I mentioned the story before, this person had finished praying and the person next to him had shook the right the person in the right and shook the man on the left. And the man on the right has, with anger, slapped his hand and he says, "This is not the sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam." So the man that got his hand slapped, he says, "Is anger and disrespect the way of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam?" It's not. So we have to be wise. We have to accept and be merciful to those, no matter how much of the big sin that they have made, no matter how big it is they have made, we are not in the position to call them kafir. We are not in the position to judge people that they are doomed. We are not in the position, brothers and sisters. We do not have that right. We do not own that right. We do not own that right to be judgmental. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who had the most knowledge out of all of us, he was the most forgiving of everyone. There's a person that committed adultery. He committed adultery and he came to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he says that I committed adultery. He admitted to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he says, "I want the law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be carried out, which is death." The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he told him, "Go and repent." So the man goes and he comes back. He says the same thing. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells him, "Go and repent." He comes back again. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam tell him, go and repent. But the man refused.